Let's just give it a quick second. She's live. Welcome, welcome, beautiful kings and queens, my royal family and friends from all over the world. I am Queen Aline, your hostess with the mostest on the RAWvolution podcast. And I am so excited today to be joined by my beautiful sister and warrior health queen, Miss Elissa Paige. Beautiful goddess who has an incredible, incredible journey to share with us today. Before I keep on going, I'm just going to make sure that we are live on the Facebook and I will tag her so that her family can be with us today. Thank you so much for joining us, those who are tuning in from near or far. Super happy to have you here. Well, let me just turn down the video, the volume. I don't know why my volume is not going down these days on my phone. It just
Technology.
like stays up.
It's
It's okay.
technology.
Yeah, usually I could turn it down, but okay, I'm just going to share it in our two groups. So this is streaming live in the RAWvolution and our RAWvolution Inner Circle. Welcome everybody joining us. I hope you can't hear the phone. I'm going to have to put it far away so we're not distracted by hearing ourselves two times.
Yes.
All right,
Gonna
good.
fall off my counter.
Yeah, you see, I could hear it. It's a little distracting. I'm gonna put this phone far away because, or you know
Take
what?
your time.
Thank you so much. I want to hear it though. Give me one moment. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm going to get my headphones and I'm gonna put it in so we can't hear what it is that's going on.
Yeah, take your time.
Okay, I'll be right back.
Take your time.
And now you know my secret. I live in my sweatpants. I look nice on the top, and then I live in my pajama pants, even when I do lives. Love
I'm in my yoga pants.
it. We got to be comfortable. It's all about the stretch, it's all about the elastic. And be
Have to be.
comfortable.
Absolutely.
I'm like, oh my God, they're going to see my tie-dye pants that I wear every single day.
They're super cute. I love it.
Thank you. You are so cute. You are adorable. I am so happy to connect with you. And I want to give a special shout out to Queen Divya, who connected us. I made a post the other day and I said, who wants to get interviewed? I want to get back out there and share amazing testimonials. And your beautiful sister reached out and said, Elissa Paige would love to. She has an amazing story. So thank you so much, beautiful. You are a super connector and keep tapping in and keep bringing people together because these stories, you know, once you hear what Elissa has gone through, you will be amazed and you will be inspired. And if you're going through a difficult time in your life, you will see that there is hope and she will really help you to hold on to that hope because what she's been through, what you've been through has just absolutely been incredible. 21 months ago, she was in a very, very dangerous motorcycle accident that her husband, her fiance, and her ended up in the hospital with 12 broken bones. She had 12 broken bones, a completely bruised face, severe nerve pain. She was in an upper body brace for 6 weeks in recovery. She couldn't drive, she couldn't move, she couldn't do anything. And this was kind of like, you know, a dark night of the soul for her. You said that you were already on this path before, but this was really like the beginning of a new, you know, rebirth. So we're going to come into that a little bit more too, and how it brought her to studying yoga. She went on to become a trauma-informed yoga and yoga nidra teacher. So she went into, you know, deep, deep studies with her yoga and her spiritual life. The food was a big part of it, spirituality. And you are here today to tell the tale. You survived. You're an incredible survivor, and such an honor to be here with you today. You're also a mama, and you have a business, a beautiful business. We'll talk a little bit about that too, called Holistically Fabulous. Right? Am I saying it right? Fabulous?
Yes.
Yes.
Little
I
play
love
on my
that.
name.
I love it so much. You are absolutely fabulous. So
Thank
introduce yourself, please, to those who don't know you, and let us know a little bit about you know what happened and where you're at today, all of it. We want to know everything.
Yeah, thank you so much. You're so beautiful.
That was
so
like four questions in one. Sorry.
No, it's okay, but it covered everything. So I'll touch on everything and then just interrupt me if I'm going too far out or if you want something else answered. Okay. So I'm Elissa. And yes, my business is Holistically Fabulous. It's still in the launching period. Before the accident, it was all with my superfoods, which you and I have spoken about. We're both part of a beautiful company that has regenerative superfoods. And I was on a path to just trying to heal the world. And then on January 7th, 21 months ago, my fiance and I were coming home and we were heading west and a kid didn't use his blinker and he cut in front of us. I don't remember any of this, by the way. He cut in front of us and I launched 30 feet off the bike and landed, and my fiance landed on his head. He broke everything. He broke his neck, his pelvis. He had two compound fractures. I woke up on the ground and I had no idea where I was or what had happened. And I remember looking up and asking, "Where's Saxie?" That's my daughter. Mm-hmm. And I had no clue. And I remember the gentleman above me staring at me in confusion. And then I said, "Where am I?" And they told me, still didn't register. And then I said, "Where's Tom?" And they said, "They're working on him." The next thing I know, I passed out, woke up in the ambulance, was looked to the EMT, and I said, "I'm so scared. I'm so scared." Then I remember being in the emergency room, and that's when everything like started coming back to me. In the ambulance, everything started coming back to me, and I started remembering what had happened. And all I was told about Tom, my fiance, was that he was in severe pain and was put into a state of sedation in a coma. Found out later that he actually was sedated and vented for 2 weeks, almost losing him 3 times in the hospital. So you were correct with all of my injuries. I had 9 broken ribs. I had a compound fracture on my T6, a broken wrist, nerve pain from my elbows to my hands, where if the nurse walked past me in the hospital, the breeze from her walking past made me want to scream, right? And because of the lifestyle I live, I was denying pain meds, which,
oh my gosh.
Yeah, I later did take 2 days of pain meds because they weren't forced on me, but there was no way of me getting through the pain. I pulled myself off of everything so that I was, after 5 days, I was released from the hospital with not even a Tylenol.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah. It was the most severe pain I've ever felt in my entire life. I had to wear, like I said, a brace that was from here to my waist. That was for the fracture in my back. It wasn't allowed to bend forward or twist. Getting up out of bed to try to stand the first time was the most excruciating pain because of all the broken ribs, which I thought I had 2, but I found out after the accident it was 9. Mm-hmm. It was the most scariest time of my life. My face was a complete mess. It was all bruised. I didn't really understand or comprehend what was going on with Tom because I was encapsulated in so much of my own pain. Mm-hmm. And I kept saying in the hospital, I'm going to get better, take care of him. I'm going to get better, take care of my daughter. I'm going to get better. Was released from the hospital, like I said, 5 days later. And that was a lot of my pushing because I knew that there was nothing medically wrong with me and I didn't want to stay because I was not eating. Mm-hmm. I was not sleeping. So the one thing I was doing was I had 2 friends that visited me that brought me like fresh squeezed orange juice and people were bringing me fruit. I got home and that's where my journey began. It was a lot of really, really hard times, crying in pain, terrified, so angry. You know, I had found out that the kid that hit us lied and said it was our fault, which it was. Yeah.
Oh my God. He
said that the light to the motorcycle was not on, which is a complete lie. It was a brand new motorcycle. And And then later actually found out not too long ago that the kid's dad showed up in the accident scene lying before him also.
Oh my God.
So there was a lot to deal with that. There was a lot of resentment and just like questioning. And just me trying to like, there was not much I could do but sit. My parents were taking care of me for months. My daughter was showering me. Mm. I was walking outside with a walker. Not that there was injuries in my legs, but I was so weak. that I was walking outside with a walker. And there was just so much questioning of life and my why. And there was a lot of difficulty in me understanding or believing how to turn this around and know that this situation happened for me and not to me. And to this day, it's still hard. I drive past the accident scene almost every day and I feel nothing. And I really had to go really deep into my healing besides with my outlook on my lifestyle, my holistic approach to everything, and really tap into some spirituality that I thought I always had, but I didn't really believe I had until this had happened, when I couldn't even sit on my yoga mat, couldn't touch my toes, couldn't sit. Mm-hmm. And I tapped into this deep spirituality of understanding that yoga was my religion and mm-hmm. yoga was my safe place. And it didn't really matter about the movement of the asanas or the poses. It mattered of what my mind was telling me I could or couldn't do, and being able to meet myself where I was at. Mm-hmm. And that really catapulted my journey to understanding how it doesn't really matter what you believe in, whatever the higher power or higher source is. What really matters is that there is one for you, no matter what that looks like. And I had always practiced yoga, like I said, but for me, it was a physical thing. And I realized that at 48 years old, like, I almost in an instant lost everything. And if I didn't follow a dream of me wanting to become certified in yoga, that it might not ever happen. And I might not have ever gotten that chance, because it's not that we can predict life, and it's not that life is short. It's that it's not promised, and we don't know what can happen from one moment to the next. So I started seeking out different yoga programs, and I realized that I was suffering from extreme PTSD and extreme trauma. And I realized that trauma is stored in our tissues. Mm. And I really felt that I had been gifted, and it sounds so completely hypocritical or opposite of what the accident was. And I still, by the way, I do have like extreme nerve pain in this hand. But I knew that I was gifted by this accident, and it was a rebirth, as you and I had discussed, for me to take advantage of the situation. And I found a beautiful sister who actually her kid went to Saxby School, which is a micro school homeschool, who was a yoga teacher who, you know, did yoga certifications in trauma-informed yoga. And it was actually I did my 200 hours, and it was a beautiful healing process for me, being able to express and learn so much more about what I was experiencing and why I went through being numb, or why I went through being frozen, and why I went through feeling nothing to feeling everything, and why to this day, when I see a motorcycle, I freeze, or why to this day, I'm constantly looking behind my shoulder. And I understood the concepts of it. So I joined the course, and I received my 200 hours, and I wasn't done yet. I still had so much more in me, so much more to learn. And so I continued on and went to the 300 hours, and I graduated with 500 hours in trauma-informed yoga. And it just opened up a huge window for me in understanding how, when you're so aligned with your spirituality and you're so aligned with your nutrition, which you and I have spoken about, and being so close to Mother Nature and eating what Mother Nature gives us, that it's such a beautiful package to be able to give to yourself and to your loved ones, to have all of these beautiful gifts at your hands. So that's basically my story in a nutshell. And here I am.
Wow. You are absolutely incredible, beautiful queen. Like, what a survivor, what a warrior, what an incredible transformation, you know, going from, because this was like pretty recent, you know, from going from this place of, you know, darkness and so much pain and suffering to being where you are today, where you literally took that suffering and that pain and you turned it into magic. You turned it into, like, it became your higher purpose, you know? And I love the saying, I believe it's Rumi who says, you know, the wound is where the light enters us. So whatever it is that we're struggling with, you know, your path was the accident, you know, that really like shook you to your core and made you question everything. Like, why is this happening? Like, is there even a God? Like, I'm sure you were wondering, like, why would this happen to me? You know, and the good things happen to good, I mean, bad things happen to good people. We wonder, like, why in the world would this happen? You know, but you were able to really transmute that. And that is yoga. That is the work of yoga. It's like transforming that dark, dense energy into light, clearing it out, healing that trauma. And really that trauma keeps us so stuck in those self-limiting beliefs and self-destructive patterns, right? To go deeper into like, oh, you know, we could look at addiction and be like, oh, why someone could just be drinking for so many years, but until they realize they have liver cirrhosis or they end up in a wheelchair or in rehab, we're not really conscious of the why is what I'm trying to say. But then when something happens that's so catastrophic, then you don't have a choice but to ask yourself like, okay, what's underneath all this, you know, and what can I really do to take responsibility for my healing? You know, not everything that happens to us is our fault, but our responsibility is to heal, and we have the choice. Are we going to become bitter? Are we going to become hateful? Are we going to become angry? You know, and maybe we do have to go through those periods as well. But then are we going to stay there? Are we going to stay in those states, or are we going to like, you know, uplift ourselves in some kind of way and try? And I think it's so beautiful that, you know, the yoga path called you. It's really a calling, you know, and you surrendered to it and you said yes to the calling, because yoga is so, so healing on every level, physically, mentally, spiritually. I'm so proud of you for having gone through that training and for doing the practice yourself, for yourself. Like, this truly is the key, you know, yoga, nutrition. And it's like, that's what in the community that I just launched, I was like, okay, we could talk about nutrition, but we need to bring in this yoga element. You know, something is missing. You know, we can't just, for me, it's not enough to just eat well. It's like, it's the foundation, but it's not enough to just eat fruit and, you know, do the whole food plant-based. Like, we have to move, we have to cleanse, detox through the movement, and yoga is such a powerful practice for that. So congratulations. And, you know, it's so beautiful that you are on this amazing, amazing healing journey and helping and inspiring others. And, okay, with all that, I can't believe you're 48. Hold on. Like, can we come back to your age?
Turning 49 on Halloween.
Okay, what? Okay, everybody, pay attention, because this woman is absolutely, you know, youthful, gorgeous, stunning. You are absolutely amazing. And the proof is in the pudding, you know? People are like, oh, veganism, does it work? And you're going to be missing protein and you're going to be this and that. But it's like, we regenerate over time, and you are the living proof of that, you know? Looking amazing, and I'm sure you've been noticing like some signs of reversing, even some signs of aging, as you've been like diving deeper into the nutrition and the superfoods and all that.
Yeah, I think, and thank you so much for saying that. I really, really do appreciate it. I think I did learn from this whole accident that I went through to, you know, stop judging the outer shell and just focus on what's inside. And I think that obviously, like you said, the spirituality coupled with everything else really does help. But yeah, the superfoods are a game changer for me. I don't even know where to begin with that, because it's like, I mean, do we begin with our soil health? Do we begin with the integrity of our food system? I mean, there's a huge movement right now with gurus that are, you know, standing on Kellogg's on their front steps. And I mean, talking about processed food, but we need to also talk about like food that's not processed, right? Yeah. Our fruits and our vegetables.
Yes.
Yeah, because the soil is only 1%, you know, nutrient dense. So you and I know that we're able to get the other 99% from our superfoods. And just being able to stay in an alkaline state and keep our body in homeostasis and balanced is, I mean, to me, the science makes complete sense. You know, so
yes. And did you discover the superfoods before your accident or after?
I did. I actually discovered them before. When I first discovered them, I was looking for something for Saxy for my daughter. And then I tried them, and now it's like every single month, you know, I'm ordering the same things, and I don't want to use the word addicted, but I am addicted to them. They're a huge staple in my lifestyle. And my diet, like we said, is completely plant-based. You know, everything that I eat is fruits or vegetables or root vegetables.
Yes. I love that. Thank you so much for mentioning that. I love it. We didn't really know that we were in the same family, you know, within the superfoods, but I talk about them too and how they help transform my life and my health. It really is a powerful complement to eating, you know, the grocery store food that we could find, you know, until we get to Belize, until we get to our tropical rainforest where my queen Khadija is. I see you, beautiful. She came on the live. That's the goal, right? Is to eat like food that is grown in regenerative ways, organic soil. It's so important. We talk about B12, but we get B12 from our soil, you know, organic soil. And unfortunately, we may be lacking it in conventional ways. So these superfoods have really helped to both of us, you know, to regenerate our health, clear our skin, all of it. So I can't be more grateful for them. And if you want more information also, please feel free to reach out to Elissa about that and talk about it. The weight loss, like there's so many things, and it's all about the gut, right? It's like when we heal our guts, we heal our life. Like that's it. And there's levels to that. You know, there's so many levels with the removing the glyphosate part, with helping to restore the gut lining, right? We have, a lot of us have like leaky gut. That's why we're not absorbing the food. That's why a lot of people are malnourished or struggling, right, with their food, because there's so much accumulation of waste in the system. So yeah, it helps to clean out. Well, I'm so
to eliminate.
That. Yes.
Yeah. And I also just started my own garden with regenerative soil. Oh, so wow. I live here in South Florida. So okay. I'm so fortunate to have a farm that's very close by that knows how to take really good care of the soil and the microbiome in the soil. So I just started, because Florida growing season is now. So that's another step. But rewinding, I know that my superfoods 100% helped get me through these injuries much quicker than if I was not in an alkaline state and allowing my body to heal.
Absolutely.
So,
and you were out of there in 5 days, you said? They must have never seen that before.
5 days. As soon as they said there was no medical reason for me to be there, I said, okay, I want out. And I got a nurse that was nice enough to help me get out. And the doctor came to see me. And he was telling me the meds that I was on. And I said, no, I pulled myself off of that when I got my discharge papers. Not Tylenol was not even on the papers. So I think I took Tylenol twice when I came home because the pain was unbearable. But other than that, I just relied on the strength that I had to know that my body was doing what it needed to do. Yeah.
You told them.
Every nurse and every doctor knew my diet, because they would, you know, bring trays of food in and I would just give them away to visitors. I just wouldn't even touch it. So
you got some grapes.
Exactly. It was watermelon. It was watermelon, coconut water, bananas. Yeah. And I had to be fed. I couldn't feed myself. So my friends were literally holding the banana for me while I was.
That must have been so hard for you. And then the recovery kind of continued at home, right? It took you a while to start to do things. You said that your daughter was helping and taking care of you for a little
while. She was showering me. My mom and my dad had to move in with me. This is incredible. They had left. They are like snowflakes in Florida. They come and go. And they were here for the holidays and they had driven home. They got home that day, that night. It was actually my ex-husband who called them to tell them that I was in an accident. They had to turn around and fly back down.
Oh my God.
Yes. And then mom, dad, if you are on, I know I say it all the time, but I am so grateful and so fortunate to them. They had to fly back down, take care of me. My mom still runs a business. She still works. My dad was making me smoothies. My mom was food shopping for me, putting drying me off after the shower. And then when I first came home, I had them rent a recliner for me because it hurt so bad to get out of bed. So I wanted to be in one of those recliners that stand you up. And I was obviously detoxing the meds the first couple of nights because I was getting up to use the bathroom to pee so many times throughout the night that my mom had to sleep in the same room with me because I couldn't pull the blankets up over me. I was sleeping in a bathrobe. Yeah. And then they took care of me. I couldn't fold my laundry. I couldn't, there was very little I could do because of my hands. And then when Tom finally pulled out of, or they pulled him off of the sedation and I was going to visit him, I was pretending like I was okay. Like I was being wheeled up to his room and I'm like, cause he was so far gone. So I was like, hey, how are, and he had no idea how injured I was. No idea. So there's many layers. And then, you know, just the whole accident happening and the kid lying was just a whole, it's something I still obviously deal with. So yeah. It's a lot of emotions involved.
Definitely. Definitely. Because justice, right? It's like, we want things to be just and right and okay. And it's not okay. I don't like when people lie either. It really, that's one of my deepest wounds, right? Like, don't lie. Like, it is such bad karma to do that. It's such bad karma. Like, anybody who lies, anybody who says wrong things about you, like, it is, that's unfortunately on them. You know, we have to deal with our own healing, but that's on them, and they will suffer the consequences of that lie. That is a big lie.
Well, and thank goodness there were two young, the same age as the kid that his was 19. There were two witnesses behind him that were 19.
Oh.
And they're the ones who told the cop the truth. So it's in the report. It's in the police report. This isn't just hearsay, you know, it's in the police report, and they were told the truth. And when I finally read the police report, I was like in a ball crying. But when Tom got home from the hospital, and it took him months to be able to walk, but once he was able to, I had the address of one witness, and I had no idea who he was, how old he was. I was like, I feel called to go and thank him because he saved. I mean, he definitely saved Tom's life. Tom had two tourniquets applied on scene. He was bleeding out. So we drove, because they live very close by. We drove to his house, and this is like divine intervention. We pulled up, and it's just like how the accident happened. They were right behind the kid that hit us. We pulled up, and a car pulled up behind us as soon as we pulled up. And I saw a guy walking to the house, and Tom said, excuse me, are you? And he mentioned the witness's name is Adam. Are you Adam? And he said, no, but Adam's behind you. And my eyes got like big as saucers, and I got out of the car. And I said, he said, I'm Jake. And I said, Jake, I said, Adam was a witness to our motorcycle accident. And he like stepped back, and he's like, and so we spoke to them and we got the whole story. And he said, Adam was the one speaking. And he said, I didn't know if I was watching you guys die in front of me. Hmm. Yeah. And he told us the entire story of what happened. And I just sat there, I was just crying and rocking back and forth. And I'm like, can I give you a hug? Can I give you a hug? Like, you guys are our angels. You're our saviors. Thank you so much. And it just was like this beautiful moment of when we were able to finally like hear what really happened and see that like these young men sincerely saved our lives. I mean, Tom more so than me, but 100%, because when the kid got out of the car that hit us, he didn't go to call rescue. He said, can I borrow your phone? He asked Adam, can I borrow your phone to call my dad?
Oh my God.
Yeah. So yeah, that's how it happened. And that's when we later found out that his dad showed up on scene also saying my son didn't do that. So his phone apparently flew in the accident. I don't know if he was on his phone. I don't know what happened, how he turned right in front of, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, so it's when we talk about karma and when we talk about how things play out for us, I think they play out exactly how they should. And even if it's like the darkest of darkest of darkest of times, it's how you like what you do with that. Mm-hmm. And how you meet yourself with that. And it's not to bypass anything that happens. It's not to say, I'm not going to feel this way because I don't want to play victim. It's knowing, okay, this happened and now what do I do with it? So there's just so many lessons to be learned, and we all have the power. We all have the power to learn our lesson and to do with that what we want, to rebirth, to completely rebirth and to make a change for the better.
Wow.
Up in here and in our heart.
How positive and inspiring. What about your husband? Like, how is he doing now? And what has been his journey with that? Is he into the yoga? Did he do his own physical therapy? Like, is he Is he okay? Is he, does so, he have the same like attitude as you, or is it a little bit harder for him?
It's definitely harder for him. He lost his entire career. Yeah, he was a hairstylist, and his right, he had the compound fracture on his right arm. So his wrist, the way that it healed, one bone grew back longer and one shorter, and it's out of joint. So the right hand doesn't turn and doesn't flex and extend. So he can't still, he's still able to do a couple of clients a day, but not, he really did lose his whole business. So he had to pivot. He just got his real estate license, but the pain that he feels every day, he said, he always explains it as like, he always says he can understand how people can get addicted to pain pills. He's not, thank goodness. His way of dealing with things, he does not do yoga. He's done it a couple of times with me, but it doesn't register with him, which is okay. I think he dives a little bit more into religion here and there. He's like I said, he's completely fused in his cervical spine. So he's unable to turn. So he has to turn his whole body. And the nerve pain in his feet is like the nerve pain in my hand, but he's on his feet. Like my hand, I can deal with it because it's my hand. But for his feet, he can't really wear socks and shoes comfortably. He, after the accident, he was calling me a lot when he was able to like finally come to at like 6 a.m. He'd be waking me up just crying. And I would like try to coach him and talk him through it. So he was able to release a lot of that in the hospital. And I say to him all the time, how are you getting through this? Because I have a lot of moments where I'll just cry, something will happen or I'll see something and I'm still going through it. Mm-hmm. And I guess he just deals with it differently. But he's a warrior for being where he's at. It's incredible. And he realizes he has a purpose here. Mm-hmm. Being that he almost died 3 times. He was in respiratory failure when he was brought into the hospital. Ooh. He had a pulmonary embolism during surgery, one of his surgery. He's had like 9 surgeries. I'm sorry, 12. 12. Whoa. Yeah, I think he had like 9 or 10 in the hospital. I might be a little bit off, but it's more than 9. yeah, when they took off the tourniquets, he went into respiratory distress. And then they took him into a surgery another day and he had a pulmonary embolism. Mm. And then he had pneumonia. And the first night he was in the ICU, the nurse was like, they said the machines were just going off the entire time. So Whoa. He definitely has a purpose.
Wow.
Yeah.
You must have been so scared of losing him in those moments. Like the uncertainty must have been really difficult for you.
I didn't know. Mm-hmm. Nobody was really telling me how bad it was. All I knew was I was home in so much pain and I couldn't talk to him because I wasn't able to drive. I couldn't get to him unless somebody took me. And the first couple of weeks I was in so much pain, it wasn't happening. So I only saw him one time because I wasn't able. One time, one of my friends wheeled me up the night before I got released to see him. And it just didn't, I think when you're in that much pain, it just wasn't registering to me. And then, like I said, they weren't telling me the exact truth of the matter, to the extent of how bad it was. And then when I went to see him, it just was me pushing through just to be there with him when he was finally awake. But it's, I mean, there's just so many things that happened when he was in the hospital, like so many, like, the doctors told him he was going to have drop foot. The doctors told them, like, they were saying, like, there were so many grim factors, like so many grim diagnoses that were being thrown at us. And he just is a miracle. And we went to Trauma Survivor Day at the hospital this year. And everyone that was, you know, everyone that was caring for him at the hospital was like, you are a miracle. Wow. Because, yeah. So, and I'm sorry, I trip over my words because it's hard to believe that I'm talking about myself in this situation. So I kind of feel like I'm up here and I'm talking about this other person.
So incredible. I'm so happy that you both made it and that you are, you know, getting stronger by the day and him too. And I'm so sorry that this had to happen. You know, it's so unfortunate. But he'll find his way. And I'm sure that, you know, something beautiful will emerge from this. You know, if we just allow that to happen, I'm sure he'll find like a new calling, a new purpose. Maybe his higher purpose is to do something completely different, to maybe share his story. Like, who knows what it is, but definitely he's here for a purpose, to help and inspire, speak, to help others, you know, in some kind of way.
So yeah, I agree on that for him, for me, for everybody involved. You know, you have to think about also all of our loved ones that were involved, the stress that they had to go through as well, like seeing us, how we were. And I'm so grateful for them. Tom was in a motorcycle club, and, you know, all of the brothers and sisters were, you know, there to help us, all of our friends. So, you know, for him too, there's a lot of loss. He lost that. Like, he can't ride a motorcycle again. He surfed. He can't surf again. He can't turn his, you know, so there's a lot of loss, but there's so much gain. There's so much gain. So we have to just keep thinking in the positive.
That's really beautiful. Ooh, I'm just like taking it all in.
I know.
I'm just like really feeling it and visualizing it, and just like really sending you both so much love and, yeah, gratitude for both of you for being here and choosing to fight. I think there's a will to live. You know, I think when it's someone's time, well, not sometimes it's conscious, sometimes it's not conscious, but when somebody's fighting so hard for their life and they go like that and they, you know, almost die three times, there's a purpose for their life, you know?
There is absolutely a purpose. And I sent you the pictures before our chat of what we look like in the hospital, just so you can have a visual. It's unreal.
It wasn't pretty, you guys. Yeah. Nothing nice about that picture.
It's unreal. So, you know, there's so many messages here, but I think the biggest message is like to literally find your joy and like find what sparks your joy, and just to cancel out all the other noise in your head, like all the noise in your life, all the toxic energy, all the negative energy, and just live in your purpose and your joy and find your why and your reason and follow that, because tomorrow is not promised. The next, I never in my wildest dreams imagined that I would be in that position that I was in. So I feel so fortunate to be able to have a different perspective on life and know that my purpose is something that matters. It matters. And just to find, like, especially in this crazy world we live in, this craziness that's happening, like, just spark joy everywhere you go. Just smile, just be you, be crazy, be unique. I always tell Saxie, nobody remembers ordinary. Nobody.
Yeah. I love that.
Be weird.
Oh my God. I tell my daughter the same thing. I'm like, you're weird. Be proud. I'm weird.
Yeah. I know.
It's exactly. Good to be different.
Yeah.
And so were you thinking about doing yoga before the accident? You said that this really sparked your desire, but I feel like there was something going on before. Like, is this something that you'd been thinking about and kind of like putting off a little bit? Like, oh, I want to, but not really fully going for it.
100%. I've been practicing yoga for many, many, many years, over 20 years. Mm-hmm. And it's always been an idea in the back of my head to become certified in yoga. But I never wanted to put in the time because it's extensive and it's very time consuming. So I just put it on the back burner and I just practiced. And right before the accident, I had found a different style of yoga. It was called Inside Flow. And it wasn't exactly the philosophical type of yoga like that I became certified in, but it was a very flowy, like dancey type of yoga. It's beautiful to watch. And I love expression through motion because emotion is energy in motion. Yeah. And I find that when you're moving or when you're dancing, like you're really able to like somatic healing, right? You're able to like just move through those feelings and get them out. And so that was on my radar. And then even after the accident, it was on my radar until I started doing some research and I came in contact with my friend Katie, and she explained to me what her yoga was about. And I was like, I'm going for it. And I was back and forth for a little bit with it. And I spoke to my mom about it. And I was like, I don't know what to do. And she's, you know, she, you know, asked, you know, what's holding you back? And for me, it was, you know, it was finances. And my mom did gift me the course. Again, Aww. Forever grateful. Thanks, Mom. Because she, I know, I love you, Mom, if you're on here. Because she saw the spark in my eye and she knew how I felt about it. Yeah. And that's where I really learned all these like important like nuggets, like I said, Like, I always thought yoga was physical. It's not physical. Mm-hmm. It's not. It's just like an added bonus of being able to feel in your body. But it's just about the emotion. It's about sitting, not an ego. It's about being a witness. It's about just feeling everything. So there couldn't have been a better time or place. So again, like, things happen for us. I wanted to do this. The accident happened. Okay, here's your message. Run with it. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I got to, you know, fulfill that dream.
Incredible. And are you teaching right now? Like, do you feel called to teach? Do you do online classes, in-person classes? How has that been?
So right now I'm just teaching one client for now. I'm trying to figure out what my calling is with it. I know I want to do private and online and workshops.
Yeah.
Because of the certification being in trauma-informed yoga, I want it to be more personal. Because I think that there is a lot of gravity to trauma-informed yoga. And trauma doesn't have to be you going through a motorcycle accident. It could be a divorce. It could be anxiety. It could be just daily stress. These are all traumas that build up. It could be childhood trauma. It could be anything. But I really want to help people understand how much love they are, how much they have to offer. So my goal is to build a practice that is more individualized, whether that translates to doing it online one-on-one or offering just more classes that kind of follow that philosophy.
Beautiful.
So, yeah.
Well, everybody who takes your course is going to be absolutely so lucky and blessed. My sis Angela, she knows about you, and she was like, oh my gosh, she gives the best classes. So she knows you and she's taking your classes. So I would love to take your class. We'll definitely talk about that after. The first time, because you said something really interesting, and I wanted to tap on this too, to take fling to people, like how yoga can heal trauma, really. And I had something happen to me when I was in Thailand. Like, I had been practicing yoga. Actually, I started practicing yoga when I was pregnant, and then a little bit more intensely after a breakup. It's interesting that you say that, because I was like in the middle of a turmoil of a relationship, and I was like, intuitively, like, I need some healing. So that's how I started. I was living in Belize at the time, but then I traveled to Thailand to go practice with a friend that was there. And I did yoga like for 2 months, every single day. And one of the days I really unlocked, it was like we were doing a hip opener, and I just started crying. Like, I just started, and I couldn't hold back my tears. And I was like, what is, like, I was kind of like scared. I was in the middle of a class. There was other people, and I felt really self-conscious. I wasn't like that comfortable yet with crying, right? But I was like, oh, there's something to this. There is something really, really powerful and deep that's happening. Like, something's coming out of me that needed to come out, you know? So we store that trauma in the body. So maybe let's touch a little bit on that. And then, like, what maybe a little bit more in depth of what you've been learning in terms of like how yoga helps us to release that trauma.
Yeah. And it's so interesting that you say that. And I have full on body chills listening to you say that, because what a beautiful experience. And I know that it's not easy to release. Mm-hmm. And our hips store so many emotions. Our hips are huge for storing emotions. And when we do our hip openers, that's when a lot of people do notice that they might start to feel a certain way. And I can tell you from personal experience that the first time I got on my mat to do yoga, where I was actually able to like sit on my mat, I cried the entire time after mm-hmm. the accident. So there is a saying that the issues are stored in the tissues, and there's that a book called The Body Keeps the Score. Mm. So when I talked about, when I touched on somatic healing, that's a part of yoga. It's what you do to make yourself feel good, to try to get that feeling out, because trauma is not what happens to us. It's how our body reacts, or we react to it. So it's very normal that when you're sitting in a hip opening pose that might be a little bit uncomfortable, and you have to really hone in on what you're feeling and your breath, that you're going to start to open up and bring up some feelings. And you might not know exactly where it's stemming from or what it is, but the most important part is that you're moving through it, and we have to go through it to get to it. So I think it's all a part of the plan. And that is what is beautiful about trauma-informed yoga is to me, the true definition is just meeting yourself where you're at. If that means you're sitting in child's pose the entire class, that's your yoga for the day. If that means that you're sitting there and you're lying in savasana, that's your yoga. If it means that you're jumping around on your mat, that's your yoga, because that is you healing yourself and listening to what your body needs. So 100%. And I think it's beautiful that you were able to release. And did you feel better after?
Oh yeah, for sure. Yeah. And then, yes. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Well, my friend she was a good friend of mine. So she was explaining things to me and what was happening and all of that, like, you know, laying in Shavasana and having visions. And I was like, what is happening? And she goes, yeah, you went deep into your Shavasana. That's what it's supposed to be. You're connecting to spirit, you're connecting to God, you're going to, like, you know, altered states, basically. And I was like, I could do this with my breath, with the movement. I don't need psychedelics.
Like, no,
it's natural state.
Yeah, it's the eight limbs of yoga. And when you get to that last limb where you're actually able to transcend and be above yourself. I have not gotten there yet, but be above yourself and looking down, like, that is amazing that you were able to do that, to be able to be in that state where you could come out and look above at, like, what's happening from a completely blissful perspective, right? It's one of the koshas, the bliss. It's like literally getting to the center of it all. Peeling back all those layers like an onion, all those different koshas.
I didn't quite float above myself, but I had visions, like, from my third eye. So I haven't quite transcended yet.
That's okay. That in itself is you being able to be in that meditative state. Yeah. And it looks different for everybody. It could be that stillness. For me, it's not stillness. It's moving meditation. That's why I react so well to the movement of yoga. I love to move.
And I think it's so important what you say, because a lot of people struggle to get into that meditative state. And originally yoga, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it wasn't so much about the asanas as it was about the meditation. But then the asanas came after in order to help us get into that state of meditation. So the yoga is, I remember one of my teachers saying, you know, busy mind, lazy body. Busy body, quiet mind. You know, like, if we want to stop the chatter of the brain and chatter of our mind, which is kind of what we're all trying to figure out, right? How do I quiet this monkey mind? Once you start being aware that you have a monkey mind, that's the beginning of consciousness, as realizing, like you said, you're the observer of your mind. You're not a victim of these unconscious thoughts, right? Like, it's so funny. The other day I made a mistake, and I drive Uber and I made a mistake. Aww. And I was just like, oh my God, I'm so stupid. How could I miss that exit? Oh my God, this person's going to be late. You know, like, that mind chatter just started kicking in. Oh my God, she's going to give me one star. She's not going to give me a tip. Like, all these things. I'm ruining her life. Like, just relax. So I can, like, observe myself and be like, just chill. Like, you're human. You make mistakes. People will forgive you. She's okay. She's quite fine back there. Like, she's a Taurus. You know, just like, we become able to have that conversation with ourselves and to quiet the mind. Like, okay, let me just take a few breaths. It's like we get these tools for a healthy, happy life. And I'm so grateful to yoga, and you too, like, so grateful that you discovered it as well, because these are tools to, it's the difference between eating the junk food or not. It's a different, it makes a difference between going for the drugs or not, calling that silly boy or not, because you're finding that peace within yourself, outside of yourself. You're not continuously, like, going to seek and feed me, da 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 da. Like, coming from outside, you find those practices within yourself to really feel good and level up and raise your consciousness physically, mentally. Like, it's so beautiful. And my journey with yoga has been on and off over the years. You know, like, some periods I've been very, very intense into it, all the way from, like, doing Ashtanga 2 hours a day to, like, teaching a lot. But again, like, I had to find my balance. I had to kind of come out of yoga and then come back and find this, what you're saying. You know, maybe I just need to sit on my mat for 5 minutes, and that's a yoga practice. That is fine. If that's all I have in me today is to lay in Shavasana, then that's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to have a great time of mindfulness. But even just taking 5 or 10 minutes a day of, on purpose, pausing.
Intentional.
Yeah, intentional, like, stretching. When are we, like, not on our phones? When are we not distracted or talking to people? Like, our world is so fast. So yoga really does help just
and yoga down. Doesn't have to, yeah. And yoga doesn't have to be on the mat. It could be off the mat too. Yes. You could just, you know, it doesn't have to mean you actually like physically rolling out your mat. It could be you standing outside in nature, grounding with your feet in the earth and just breathing. It could be you just listening to the birds.
Oh yeah.
That's yoga off the mat, right? It's just the mat is where we practice the asanas. But like you said, yes, no, yoga wasn't, it was never about the asana. Never. It's just the beauty that it brings, like you said, to get the body in motion, but it's all about the mind. And we have so much control over our thoughts. And like you keep on touching on this beautiful word, and I keep on meaning to say something about it, consciousness, because we live in such an unconscious state. But when we really tap into that consciousness, it opens up our eyes to so much more. We're living with purpose and we're living with integrity. We're meeting ourselves where we're at. We're meeting ourselves with compassion and kindness and forgiveness. And it's just going through our day with that open book, like not listening to the chitta in our head, like the stories, right? All that you know, our mind is telling us. And just, again, just like leading with our heart, leading with love and playing witness. Maybe once in a while, like look, like not like transcend, but try to look at our lives from a different perspective, because it's all here inside of us, and we can all be beauty and love if we start to make some more conscious decisions in our life. And that the world needs it. We know yes, that. Indeed. It needs it.
Yeah, it really does. And even if we look at, you know, I don't know if it's the first principle of yoga, my yoga knowledge is a little rusty, but ahimsa. Let's talk about ahimsa.
Yeah, ahimsa.
One of the major principles of yoga, you know, and then you see like some of the yoga teachers that don't necessarily practice this, and they're not even, you know, plant-based, and
yeah,
there's a lot of hypocrisy as well in terms of like, okay, what are you teaching? I mean, one of my teachers, he was like eating steak, and I'm like, you just taught me ahimsa. Like, I don't get it.
Yeah, do no harm. Do no harm.
But
in his mind, if he doesn't feel that he's doing harm, then that's his work. Mm. I completely understand you. And I really, really hold true and hone in on that yoga philosophy, because I really don't. I mean, even when I see like bugs around the house, I'm like, oh, what do? I like really try to like, but in my mind, if I see a big spider, like I am not putting that big spider outside. Like make your choices, right?
I have my limits too. Like cockroaches, yeah. Like, I'm sorry. Like, we're going to take care of you.
You got to go. But it's true. It's trying to live with that integrity of you thinking like maybe for that yoga instructor, maybe I don't know, but you know, maybe he feels that eating a steak is not doing harm. Maybe he has a different vision of that, but I do try to live within those, you know, always do your best, do no harm, and, you know, follow through.
And amazing things happen too, to anybody who's watching. Like, there are some really beautiful gifts that the universe offers us, I believe, and I've experienced in my own life when we do that, when we practice do no harm, not just to humans, you know. It's a little bit like, you know, thou shalt not kill. People take what they want from that. People be like, oh yeah, no, I'm not, of course I wouldn't kill another human, you know, but let me just kill this pig, or let me go pay somebody to kill this pig. So you're not really like honoring that commandment, you know, which is like, I think the basis of all, you know, the original spiritual beliefs and the Essenes, you know, the way Jesus taught the peaceful way of life, right? It's Jesus had a lot in common with the Buddhists, with the yoga traditions, you know. Like, he went to study there too. He was in India, he went to Egypt. Well, we don't know exactly where he went, but I believe he went to India, he went to Egypt, you know, and we know this, but he studied with all the greats, he studied with all the sages to learn this, you know, and to learn how to live a wholesome, peaceful life. And I don't know, all the gifts started coming to me when I went plant-based, so I am never going back to having any kind of animals ever.
I am with you, girl. I'm the same way. I mean, you see the life in their eyes, like you see the emotions. I mean, I fully believe that, I mean, animals understand me. Like, I really, fully do. And I just want to also go back to what you said about when you were talking about like Jesus and like the sages and stuff. And that's what I said in the beginning of our conversation. It's all about our higher belief. No matter what that is for you, I find that if you have that higher belief and you trust in something that's bigger than you, whatever that is that you believe in, for me, it's universe, then those gifts will be granted to you if you're open to receiving. And just be careful what you ask for, because your thoughts and your words are very powerful.
Oh yeah, we speak things into existence. We are so powerful. Oh my gosh, we could go into manifestation on a whole other video.
Yeah, that's another interview.
Yeah, we could, but we definitely touch on it. You know, what we believe, what our thoughts are saying, what our words are saying, like, be impeccable with your word. That's one of the four agreements. I don't know if you've read the four agreements, yes. But it's yep. Be impeccable with your word. Mm-hmm. That doesn't just mean what you say to people, as in don't lie, be honest, be truthful, be kind, but it's also what you say to yourself. And those words will have an impact on your body. Those experiments, you know, they do with the ice cubes where they like talk to the water positively. Well, those ice cubes will crystallize in beautiful formations, like snowflake formations. And then the water that was talked down on and was like, oh, you're ugly and you're stupid and da-da-da. It was like, it was just like not the same structure at all. The water molecules were just different, right? How it was observed. The plants as well. When we talk to plants a certain way, like we are the plants, we are the water. We are those same.
We are nature.
Yeah, we're nature.
Yeah, we are nature. One of my assignments in both my 200 and my 300 yoga course was to look in the mirror and tell myself, I love you. Aww. Have you ever done that? It's really not easy.
I do it. One of my coaches, and I do it almost every day. I said, I love you fully, deeply, and completely while looking at myself. And sometimes I break down and cry.
Yes. Yeah,
it's been a practice.
Yes. Yeah. We are beautiful beings. We're all hopefully doing our best, and we have to honor that. Mm-hmm. We really do. We have to respect one another, and we have to respect ourselves, and we have to be, you have a daughter, I have a daughter. We have to be impressionable to them and teach them the way. I mean, there's social media that gets in the way. There's all the static and noise that is out there about all this, like, just look at our food, you know, if our food is able to be poisoned, then our life is able to be poisoned. I know that I'm like going off on a tangent, but I know that you understand what I'm saying.
No, it's so good. Well, I saw a little comment touching on your daughter. Somebody said, Divya says that she's an amazing dancer, Saxy. Wow.
She's a competitor. Thank you, Divya. Oh, wow. Yeah, she's a competitive dancer. Last year was her first year doing it. She loves it. She does it all, hip hop, ballet, lyrical, jazz. Ooh. She's my little shining star. I love her so much. She's my biggest teacher. She's obviously the first thing I said when I woke up from being knocked out was, we're sexy. Like, So she's a beautiful sexy little being.
We love you, girl.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. How old is she?
She's 11.
Okay.
She is 11, yeah. And she goes to this wonderful little micro school. It's a homeschool on a farm. So it's such a beautiful way to learn. It's amazing. Like, she'll be reading in the treehouse, and they do like class trips and hands-on learning. And yeah, it's awesome. She's been going this is her fourth year.
Amazing. Oh, such a good mama. She is really blessed to have you as her mom and to be growing up with such a conscious and spiritual and awake and loving mom as you, you know, doing amazing things for her. And you guys are going to be, I mean, you're our best friends. You know, it's really beautiful to have those types of relationships that, I don't know, I didn't have with my mother anyway. You know, that was a little bit more difficult. You know, she was a great mom, but I didn't have that like closeness, you know.
But now you get to have that with your daughter.
I get to have that with my daughter. Yes.
Yeah.
They're amazing. I can't wait for them to meet. I would love for our little girls to meet. Definitely.
Absolutely. You're on the East Coast, right?
I'm in Montreal at the moment. Yes.
Oh, Canada. Okay. You're all the way. Okay.
I'm up.
Yeah, you're all the way up there. Okay. Up.
But, we like Florida. Yeah. We a lot of Quebecers go there. Actually, it's so funny you say snowbirds. Like, our Quebecers come and like invade Florida.
Yes, they do. It's so funny. I know, like, when I'm like on like the beach or like in a store, like, and I see all the like Canada license plates, I'm like, okay, it's season. It should be soon.
Yeah. We'll drive those 30 hours. We don't care. My parents used to take us in the car. We four kids in the back of the car. Like, we drove, we stopped one time for the night. Sometimes And yeah, we were happy.
Yeah, the come beach. To the tropics. It's almost the tropics here. You'd be so, you would love it. I live in an area in Broward County. It's called Davie, and it's, I mean, they're building everywhere, but it used to be more farmland. But like, you'll see horses like galloping down the, you know, people riding horses. There's some farms around. Yes, like I said, the farm that I buy my soil from is amazing. So it's a little bit more, you know, like countrified than,
yes.
Yeah. So, and then the beach is right there, which the ocean is incredibly healing.
Wow. Well, I'll
20 minutes away.
You. I'll have to come and visit you one day.
Yes. Yeah. Girls trip.
Definitely. Oh, yeah. Well, it was such a beautiful conversation. I don't know if there anything else that you'd like to share with everyone before we close off.
Just thank you for this opportunity, and thank you for meeting with me and letting me share my story. It's a huge help to me in my healing to be able to share it. Because I feel like I do live it every single day. It's something that I'm reminded of every day. And just my message to everybody is just, like I said earlier, like find your joy and like do the thing. Love yourself, do the thing, and take care of your health. Really, sincerely. Take care of your health.
Yes, I wanted to touch on this too before when we were talking about the lifestyle, like how your diet affected you before we close off. Yeah. Osteoporosis and the lies that we've been told too. Like why you're saying that you were able to recover better. I just wanted to touch on that really quickly because
I
100% agree that, sorry. No, it's okay.
Drank,
me too.
We
trailed off. It's fine. I love it. This is like, for me, this isn't about being like official. It's just like, let's have a conversation. Well, I rarely prepare for these. I just love to, because then you're just like so stuck with like, oh, what's my next question? And what's my next question? I just really rather have conversations, you know, and have these amazing, like it was very organic. So osteoporosis. So like we've been lied to, right, about dairy and eating meat and things like that. But actually what happens is it leaches out the calcium from your bones. So osteoporosis is also more predominant in places where people drink dairy. You know, like you won't find it in other countries that don't drink dairy or eat cheese. So dairy is a big culprit for osteoporosis, meaning like when you would fall or when you would have an accident, you would have bigger tears, bigger breaks, harder recovery time, harder, the skin repairs itself longer. Like when we're plant-based, vegan, high raw vegan, or fruit-based, like your skin is going to heal so quick. You're going to see like you have a cut and you're going to heal way quicker. And you're like, when I started seeing that, I started asking questions, you know, because I always was told the opposite, you know?
Yeah.
But everything helps. Maybe
everything.
Yeah.
Everything helps. I learned that. So during my pregnancy, I was vegan. Mm-hmm. I think I was eating eggs during my pregnancy, but I had been vegan before that, but I think I was eating eggs. But I remember I was diagnosed with gestational diabetes, which I'm not even gonna get into because the way they test it, this is where like I had been on my journey. This is where I really started like learning more about it. And I went to, they sent me to a nutritionist and she's like, okay, so to get your calcium, you're going to have to drink milk. And I looked at her, I said, what are you talking about? And then I'm like, I don't eat any dairy. And she asked how I was going to get my calcium. I'm like, green leafy vegetables.
Yes.
So that I understand. But yeah, I had 12 broken bones. Yeah. I was supposed to be in that brace for 8 weeks. I was in it for 6.
Wow. See?
So I was even, one of my really good friends is a Dr. Morris practitioner, and she had given me herbs for my bones and they actually were making me nauseous. So I couldn't take them. I mean, a lot goes on after, you know, an accident. So I actually wasn't even taking them. And I can tell you that I healed on a very high fruit diet. Mm-hmm. I was eating sweet potatoes every night because my body needed it, but I listened to my body. But other than that, everything was fruit. I was eating melon. My dad was juicing orange juice for me every morning. My mom was cutting up melon for me. I was having my superfood smoothies and I was having avocado, tomatoes, cucumbers, and sweet potato every night. That was my diet and I healed all my bones.
Amazing.
That's yeah, that's it. That's it. Our wonderful superfoods and the fruit that Mother Earth gifts us on her own, unless we go and destroy the trees.
This is how it's done. This is how it's done. I'm so happy you shared like what it is that that you were eating in a day, because this is basically the mucusless diet healing system. Professor
Absolutely.
Arnold Arendt teaches it, Professor Spira, and this is basically it. And you know, I'm all about like the raw living foods, and I'm also about the transition. I'm also about like, yes, having the sweet potato, yes, having the steamed zucchini. Like if that's what your body craves and needs, like go for it. We don't always want to, you know, eat the raw, like I'm 95%, and I've opened up the door to having the sweet potato, having
Me
the
too.
broccoli, you know, and I feel amazing. I feel really, really good. You know, I have super high energy, and I see my energy dipping down when I start going into like a restaurant vegan food and the oils. And if I eat a little bit of rice or pasta, that's when like I start to dip a little bit. But if I keep it like whole food, plant-based, raw, mostly raw, and then a little bit of sweet potato, like that's amazing. And I think that's super, super healthy, because it's all about the digestion. It's all about the elimination and the digestion. So I much rather have a sweet potato than like a big bowl, for me anyway, a big bowl of like even like pumpkin seeds or those like I find that a little bit healthier. I mean, a heavier, like it's good, you know, if people feel good on that. But for me, like I kind of started thinking, go back to basics, read the mucusless diet healing system, and
yeah,
with that, because those are foods that flow. A vegetable soup will flow through the body.
Absolutely. It's about the hydration of the food, eating alkaline. You know, it is science. You know, there's a lot of argument out there about science, but we are alkaline species. You know, we are plant-based. Our teeth show that we're supposed to live on a plant-based diet, and eating steamed vegetables and sweet potatoes is perfect. I mean, I do it more now because I notice that it grounds me. I have a lot of like energy that I try to like bring myself down. So those foods work for me, but they're all high vibrational foods. Yes, fruits are the highest vibrational foods on the planet, but 100% listening to your body and eating intuitively and nourishing, 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 nourishing.
Love it.
So yeah.
Thank
yeah,
you.
And giving our digestion, I'm sorry.
Yeah. No, go ahead.
I just was going to say, and giving our digestion the freedom to digest our foods easily.
Absolutely. It takes how long to digest meat? I think it takes like 3 to 5 days. That's what they say. I think it actually takes longer than that for a piece of meat to be digested. So if you imagine putting that on top of another piece of meat, and then having, you know, chicken for dinner, and then we're having eggs for breakfast, and then we're putting a cheese and ham sandwich for lunch. Like I used to have animal products like every single meal before.
Yeah.
I didn't know. And you've been doing it even longer than me. I've been 10 years, you know, plant-based, but before those 10 years, I mean, what was wrong with a bologna sandwich? Like I had no idea. I was just so insane, you know, hot dogs, like I ate all this stuff. So when I think about the sludge and why I wasn't able to go poop, like I was distended, I was constipated, my stomach hurt.
Of course. Yeah, I haven't had, okay, so here's a good testament for people that are questioning or unclear, or maybe want to dabble in maybe giving up red meat. I am turning 49 this month. I have not had red meat since I was 15 years old.
Wow.
I'm okay.
Yeah.
So if anybody is questioning or curious around it, I'm a testament.
Incredible. Oh my gosh, you started really, really young.
Yeah. I was eating some animal products though. I'm honest, you know, I would, you know, have some animal products then not, but red meat, not since I was 15. Yeah.
Incredible.
And then pure, pure vegan since it'll be 10 years.
Okay. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
We got on at the same time.
Yeah. On and off, but like strictly vegan. Yeah. 10 years.
Absolutely incredible. And it takes a long time
to transition,
to regenerate. Yeah. Like most people will do that. We'll go back and forth, have experiments. I would do that same too, like 6 months vegan and then vegetarian at the time, and then go back to eating meat, and then have those experiences. You know, if you're curious, try it out, try a week, try 2 weeks, but also I say go longer than that, because you won't necessarily feel amazing, because meat is such a stimulant, right? So you may actually go through a period. I always give like this disclaimer, right? Like you may feel worse before you get better. You may feel worse before you feel better, because you're going to allow your body to start purging out all those toxins. And, you know, people are like, oh, I went vegan and I started feeling amazing. Like, yes, you're going to feel good, but then you're also maybe going to have periods where you don't feel so good. So just be patient, and you know, you got to cross over this healing process to get to the other side.
And yeah, it's the body trying to come back in balance and heal. And we can go through healing crises when we're really digging deep, but it's worth it. It's so worth it. There's like a sense of clarity when you like, give the digestion a chance to like easefully digest. You feel lighter. You feel like more energy. You feel more connected.
Eating to nourish, not to punish. I like to say eat to nourish yourself, not to punish yourself. And sometimes we don't really realize that we're punishing ourselves with these foods until we start getting sensitive and feeling like the full effects of them. Sometimes, I mean, I still have those experiments where I'm like, the next day, I'm like, why did I punish myself? I knew what was going to happen.
That's so funny. I never heard that expression. I love it. Eating to nourish, not to punish. I never heard that one.
Me too. It's mine. I just made it up.
Oh, well, you need to coin that. Let's make some shirts. I'm spinning off another business for you.
You can quote me.
I will.
Oh, you're so amazing. Thank you so much. Please connect with our beautiful sister, Elissa Paige, on Facebook and Instagram as well. And if you're interested in learning more about yoga practicing, please reach out to her. You're such an incredible light, and truly, truly, I'm so happy we had this conversation. And I would love to have some more if you want to touch on other topics, within whatever we talked about or beyond, you know, I would absolutely love that to connect. And thank you so much to everybody who joined us.
Thank you. And I'd be honored to, and let's just put it out there. We will.
Yes, we absolutely will. Definitely.
Yeah. Thank you everybody that joined. And thank you so much for hosting this. I really do appreciate it.
My greatest pleasure. And we will, you know, have this on YouTube and other platforms as well. So thank you so much to everybody. We love you and keep up your amazing work, and love to your family, love to your beautiful daughter, your husband, and your parents. It takes a village. And I love that. I love that. I think if you don't have a family of your own, like, go find one. Go to meetings. There's AA groups. There's connection groups. There's so many different free communities. Like, go find yourself a tribe, because having a family, having a support system is everything in recovery. And I really, you know, I don't believe in, like, a lot of people are like, oh, I don't have any friends. I say that sometimes, like, oh, I don't have any friends around me, but I'm coming out of that victim mentality and putting myself out there more and going to make friends, like, go make friends. You know, there's people out there that want to support you on your journey. And I have an amazing family and father and daughter as well. So, you know, we're blessed when we're well surrounded.
That's awesome. And I totally agree. And do you see what you did there? You used your darkness, your shadows, and you saw the light. You said that sometimes you live in that victimhood, but you recognized it. And now you can use it for good, because you recognize it. I love it. Yoga.
Yes. I just made a post in a Montreal light workers group with my little juices. And I'm like, anybody want to like connect? And I met this amazing sister 2 days ago, and she was like, let's meet in person. You know, sometimes it's just like stays online, but she was like, no, like, I really want to meet you. And we met in the flesh, and it was just like, it blew my mind how in tune we were with each other. Like, it just was just like this, like, it just felt really good, really natural, really flowy. So I think especially us women is a time of coming together. I'm feeling this like deep calling to come with my sisters, with my women, like deep healing. Like, I haven't been with a partner in a long time. Like, just my women is everything.
Your
like
tribe.
I'm building those friendships. Yes.
So important. It's so important. And like we said before, you ask, you receive. Thank you, universe. And now here you are building your tribe. That connection is so important, especially with people that like support you and are like-minded and non-judgmental. I think it's the most important thing. Non-judgmental. And they're not judging you. They're judging themselves that they're being judgmental. So lessons learned.
I got a few of those around me.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. We all do.
Together we empower each other and we rise. So let's
keep exactly.
Thank you so much for your beautiful energy and your time today. I love you, and I can't wait till our next one.
Yes, I love you too. Thank you so much, and thank you for all of your time. I so appreciate
it. My pleasure.
Okay, have a beautiful day.
Bye, everyone. Peace.
Bye.
Bye.